We're going to start the service. Let's all stand. We've got a good service tonight. We're looking forward to hearing the testimonies. We're going to sing the song, By Faith. And it's a hymn, one of the new hymns, about, and it's all about mission. So let's sing it together.
One, two, three.
Pay attention to the words of this song as we sing. Everybody at Bel Air has an equal share in what's being done
in Brazil. You are gracious enough to allow 3% of our budget to go towards that work, and you're gracious enough to let me go and be part of it. And we just want to say how thankful we are that we're at a church that takes a great commission seriously. So thank you. I can tell you that there's believers where they used not to be. So we're going to get into it in a minute. What we're going to do, we're going to start off with a little video, some pictures and music, kind of get you in the mood. And then each and every one of our team members are going to come, and they have a section, and we're going to try to tell a story of what God is doing through this partnership on this last trip. And then we'll have a testimony by Duval. Y'all heard about him, the mango tree, and he's been so gracious to do his testimony, and we're going to play that. And then at the end, Carrie Hezel is going to come and tell you what God's doing in a personal way through this partnership. So this promises to be a night of great rejoicing, of great thanksgiving to God that He would allow a sleepy little church like Bel Air in South Mississippi to truly take the gospel where it's never been heard. Would you pray with me and we'll get started. Father, how we thank you for each and every one here. How we thank you, Lord, that we, through the grace of Jesus and through the power of the Holy Spirit, Father, are becoming more and more ingrained with a missional mindset. That, Father, missions is not something we do and then we're done. Missions is who we are. Father, that is the description of our Savior, who said the Son of Man is came to seek and to save that which is lost. So, Father, I pray for each one of the team members now as they come. Give them clarity of speech and thought. And, Father, through it all, when we leave here tonight, may we walk out of here saying what a Savior Jesus is. For His glory we pray. Amen.
Yeah. You are holy, holy. Lift it up.
Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy.
You are holy,
holy, holy.
I want to see you.
Holy as
my heart. Yeah.
Holy as my heart.
First of all, I want to praise the Lord that our leaders had a vision that we needed to be prepared spiritually before going on this mission. We spent 6 weeks studying, preparing, and praying for God's direction. And it didn't take us very long to find God's direction. I want you to envision with me the construction of a major railroad going across the West. Brother Richie Allen is the track layer. He knows what direction the Lord has for this mission, and he's out laying tracks weeks and months ahead of everybody coming there to help. The pastors are the engineers. Pastors of the different sponsoring churches are in direct contact with the track layer. They understand his direction for the track, and it's their job to keep that train moving in the proper direction. And sometimes you got to go around hills and valleys and whatever to get the train going in direction, and that's their job as the engineer. As volunteer missionaries, we are like the train cars, carrying the tools and manpower to get the mission done. Since Bel Air has joined this mission, God's changed direction of the tracks, and I'm sure he'll probably do it again. He knows what direction those tracks must go in order to achieve his goal. Currently, right now, our understanding is the goal is to have Kialumbo churches in Kialumbo villages ran by Kialumbo pastors spreading the gospel to their own people. And that's what our goal, and that's what we're reaching out trying to do. We believe that our part of this mission is to work with the Brazilian churches there. Right now, we have three relationships with three Brazilian churches there and reaching out to three different Kialumbo villages. And our job is to work with them, coach them, train them in the proper way to go out to visit You know, there's just no way we can make an impact in Brazil with two mission trips a year. However, if we work with those local churches there, they can spend the time and go out on a regular basis to work with and guide and direct those folks out in the Quilombo villages. And we've had an epiphany this trip that the proper way to approach these Quilombo villages out there in Brazil is the J2 way. Now, it's unfamiliar words for us, but it's basically like being their way. They would say, for an example, our way, you are like us. And J2 is not approaching these villages with loud amplified music and preaching, but with patience, understanding, love, and Bible story. I had a hard time understanding something that Brother Richie explained to us one day as Brother Randy asked, is there anything we can do around here? I know there's this room in the back that you've been wanting to have completed and finished. And he said, really, my main goal is to get this fence painted out here. And he's got a big fence about 6 foot tall. It's solid. And he said, I really need to get that painted. So we started, okay, let's paint brushes. Where can we get all this stuff? And he's like, no, you can throw all that out. I was like, what do you mean? Don't they have rollers? And he says, well, you have to understand here, you go down to the hardware store and you buy a box of powder and you pour water in it and you mix it up. And then you get a broom and you sling it up on the wall. And I'm thinking, wow, this is just not a real sufficient way of doing things. And it bothered me for a little while. In a couple of days, I realized, well, that's just the J2 way. That's just doing it their way. And they're offended when you try to come with your special fancy ways and other things. So it took me a little while to get that, how that would offend them. You see, other religions have come in and tarnished religion for all of us. They've come in and not been people of their word. They're for different reasons. And if we are to be successful with reaching these people for Christ, we have to be patient, loving, kind, and understanding, and most of all, people of our word. And remembering at all times to be J2. And from a first-timer's view, we started this mission looking for God's direction, and we found it not long after we arrived. Again, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for allowing me to be a part and experiencing. When you get back, people ask a lot of questions, and you search hard to try to find words to express your experience, and there just aren't enough. So I just want to thank you very much.
Thank you, Johnny, and thank you, Bel-Air folks, because what you do, even though you're not there, it is important to what goes on in Brazil and to the people in Brazil. From the photos, you saw that we were not in America any longer, and we had to get out of our American way of thinking to be more J2, as Johnny said. And that is part of what cross-cultural ministry is about. You have to get away from your thinking and get into the thinking of the Quilomboas as well as the Brazilian people there. Some of the barriers we faced with that is that the Quilomboa people are the adults, many of them are illiterate. They don't read, they don't write. So when you're going into those villages, bring in a heavy, your best, biggest Bible or any Bible is an impediment to them accepting Christ, or it can be. Some of them, one woman has said that she could not become a follower of Christ because she could not read. So she felt that until she could read, she could not become a follower of Christ. We know that that's not true. And so taking that in, we have to realize you have to leave the Bibles on the bus. The Bibles never come out in the Quilomboa village. They can go to a Brazilian church, which is different. So we had to learn that how we approached the Brazilians was different than how we approached the Quilomboa people. The Quilomboa people are also based on an oral tradition and oral history that's passed down. So they don't read or write. Handing out tracts, handing out really anything is pretty much useless. So we had to realize what is going to be the way to effectively reach these people for Christ. Another barrier we faced was the fact that they're polytheistic. They may claim to be Catholic, or they may just be Macumba, which is their witchcraft religion. But even Catholicism has Macumba and witchcraft elements in it, which lends itself to be very polytheistic. And they even have a demon god named Jesus. So we can't go into the villages and start talking about Jesus, because they cannot separate their little case G God with Jesus. It's just a barrier there. So what we did through storytelling, that is concise and reproducible, we were able to tell Bible stories and the key truths associated with those Bible stories. And because of their polytheistic religion, we had to go back to the beginning. We had to go back to creation, because we needed them to realize that there's one creator, that you don't need to be worshiping the tree. You need to be worshiping the one true creator. So we would go in and we would tell them a Bible story. We would maybe Genesis 1 if we were starting at the beginning in their village. And we would tell them about the one true God, that He created everything from nothing, and that He did it effortlessly. It was easy for Him, and we would give them these key truths. It would be concise, and it would be something that they could pass on to other people as they wanted to. So we needed it to be concise and reproducible. After creation, we had a perfect world. We had to let them know how sin entered into it. So we had a following Bible story, Genesis 3, when sin entered. And then we went on. So we were getting these key Bible stories that kind of flowed where we wanted them to be, that started at the beginning so that they could get a true foundation of who God was, and what He did. So we brought the entrance of sin into the world, the fact that a sacrifice was needed. Eventually, we got to the birth of Christ, the calling out of disciples, and then finally, the ultimate sacrifice of the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, and then the resurrection. So we wanted to give them those basic core principles that they could understand, that they could reproduce to other people, other generations, other believers or non-believers. While it sounds basic to us, we needed to go back to the basics with them for all of those reasons. And because of the demon god, we could not just jump into Jesus saves type of message. Some of that was getting the Brazilian church, who are there on a day in, day out basis, essentially with the Quilomboa people. We had to get them on board with this as well and teach them how to do this as well. So I want you to imagine we're in a Quilomboa village and you don't read or write. And so we're going to tell you the story, Peggy is, of Genesis 22, of Abraham's sacrifice. And we're going to show you what we did and how we got those key truths established to the Quilomboa village. And this is just an example Like I said, we started at Genesis. We had to lay that groundwork down. So Peggy's going to show you Genesis 22, what we did.
To tell you a story tonight about Abraham. Abraham was a man who was dedicated to God. God decided that he would test Abraham. So he called him, "Abraham, Abraham, here I am, Lord. Abraham, I want you to take your son, your only son, the one that you love so much, and I want you to take him to the region of Moriah, to a mountain that I will show you. And there I want you to sacrifice him as a burnt offering." So the next morning, Abraham got up, and he got two of his servants, and they saddled the donkey. He chopped the wood. He got his fire and his knife, and they began their journey. 3 days later, Abraham looked up and he saw the place that God was showing him. And he told the servants, he said, "You stay here and we are going to go and worship the Lord. And we will be back." So he took the wood and he placed it on Isaac to carry. He got his fire. He got his knife. And they began to walk down the path. As they were walking, Isaac said to him, "Father." He said, "Yes, son." He said, "You have the fire, we have the wood, but where is the burnt offering for the sacrifice?" And Abraham looked at Isaac and he said, "God will provide." They continued on, and when they reached the spot that Abraham knew God wanted him to be at, he began to build the altar. After he built the altar, he took the wood, he laid it out on the altar, and then he took Isaac and he bound him up. He placed him on the altar, he drew his knife, and as he lifted it up to slay Isaac, he heard the Lord saying, "Abraham, Abraham." And he said, "Yes, Lord, I'm here." "Do not touch your son. The one that you love so much, your only son, do not touch him. You have proved that you are faithful to me by being obedient to what I ask you to do." As Abraham lifted his head up and looked, in the bushes there was a ram whose horns were caught in the thicket. He went over, he got the ram, and he and Isaac sacrificed the ram on the altar. When they got through, the angel of the Lord said, "Abraham, Abraham, because you have been faithful to me, your ancestors will be many. It's more than the stars in the sky and the grains of the sand of the earth." God, this story illustrates that God does demand a sacrifice from us. However, God does not require human sacrifice from us. There was a time, this story was given to illustrate the sacrifice that God would provide for us, and this is in a story that you will learn about later. So this is our example of storying. After we got through, we would ask them some questions that would lead to the truths of the story, and I'm not going to ask y'all any questions to see who listened to my story. But I am going to tell you, just bring out the truths that are in this story that we wanted them to know about, that we would lead them to through the questions that they ask. And those were that God demands the sacrifice we love most. This is to show that he is our first priority and that nothing comes before him. It is to demonstrate Abraham's obedience. As much as he loved Isaac, he loved God more. Isaac's obedience, he was willing to lay down his life for God. Would you be willing to lay down your life for God? That Abraham was prepared. He had the wood, he had the fire, and he had the knife. and that God is faithful, that God provides the sacrifice.
Hi, this is my second trip, and my portion, they only going to let me talk a little bit, so I'm going to tell you about the relationship building, and it's not like Peggy was so excited about her storytelling, she jumped off the bus and said, let me tell you a story. It doesn't happen like that. So we had to have training in the culture. And you learned about J2 and how we were going to be their way. We're going to be like them, which was a little bit different from my first trip. We didn't have that type of training. So I thought that was really a good thing for us to understand. You're not going to let a bunch of pasty white folk in your house unannounced. You want to know what's going on. And so do they. So you have to be invited before you go into the Quilomboas. Now our partner churches, they know we're coming and they're all excited, so they get the word out, and then the Quilomboas have to say, yeah, we want them to come out. So there's an invitation, and it's not that you get to stop by for a quick visit. So they get excited and they want to prepare, so you just pretend like your in-laws are coming, you're going to get ready. So they do the same thing. And in preparation, that could mean that they're going to have food for you, or they're going to prepare the place that you're going to meet. And this happened a couple of places. They sweep out under the tree where we're going to meet. So our meeting would actually be in underneath the tree, but they would prepare that area as much as they could to welcome us and to be a host to us. Let's see, and they're very excited to receive us, and that's not just the Quilomboas, that's our partnership churches, and you see they're just proudly wearing their shirts, their t-shirts, and they're very excited to see us, and they remember us, and I can't even imagine why I was allowed to go on the first trip, and then I get to go on another trip, and they remembered me, and they were like, oh, you cut your hair. Even the Fortaleza, the Quilomboa that we went to, they recognized that I cut my hair. And I'm like, how do you? So they know, they pay attention to what's going on. And so we learned about building the relationships. We learned about what their culture was and how things worked for them on a usual basis. We go in for, hey, let's get together and have a quick lunch. We go to lunch and then we got things to do. We're out of there. Well, they don't do that stuff. We have to spend the time. And so this trip, we spent time, we met with leaders and pastors. We trained on the Bible story. We ate lunch with Duval and his family, and you'll hear his testimony later, which I felt so honored to meet him. And then this trip, I met him on the first trip. This trip, we spent a day with him and his family. And then we actually got to spend a night in Fortaleza. And there is Ana Lucia in Fortaleza. Showed me her garden. So I got very excited, and I'm a little disappointed to let you know that they grow okra down there too, and I can't imagine why. So on my first trip, I told you that God had me like thousands of miles away from home playing wiffle ball. I had no idea why, and so okay, whatever. This time I got to play frisbee. Doesn't matter that I don't know what I'm doing, because I look like an expert out there. And those kids know, and they remember, and they were excited to see us, and the frisbee was just amazing for them, and pretty much me too, because I never throw a frisbee. So I get to see it the second time. I got to see, hey, here's the wiffle ball, and we're going to play with you, and you don't know me, and I can't speak your language, but do what we do. And they played. And so the second time we came, they came to us, and they were excited. And so the seed is there, that there's something good, and come and see. And then later on, you'll see them sitting, listening to the Bible story. So I'm very honored and humbled that I got to witness that by my own eyes. And it was a wonderful, wonderful trip. And that's not where the relationship began. It is not about the team of the 8 people who were so fortunate to go, because there's so many more. And so I'm going to tell you a little bit about the players. There's a lot of them. Ev Elijah is the bus driver. And he is the bus driver on my first trip, and he is the bus driver on the second trip, and God willing, he will always be my bus driver, because he is the greatest bus driver on the earth. I've been on several buses, and this man can take you from paved to not paved and do a really great job at it. He cares for us. It takes very good care of us. And then we would not have made it out of the airport without 3 fantastic interpreters. And I'm going to give you their names just because they are so significant to what we do. It's Rafael, Emmanuel, but we call her Manu, and Patricia. And Patricia, bless her heart, got to live with Jackie and I for the entire trip, which, you know, living with 2 American girls could be interesting. And we were supposed to help her with her English, so that was good luck for her. And then we have Link Up and Heather and Richie, who have been with our partnership every step of the way, and they were there with us the first few days, and they've held our hand, and I don't know where we would be. I don't even know that we would know without them. And then we have Pastor Randy, or you can call him Pastor Hangie, because they do. And he has an obvious love of missions, and he has shared it and brought it to Bel Air Baptist. And then Brian Cameron, who I know it was a homework assignment, but it still counts. He put together our work study, and he worked with us through our work study book. And it was a big eye-opener, a grounding to help us embrace what we're doing and how we're going to go about it. There's our family and friends. And this time, nobody had to have their children watch after, because they were all grown. But we have... My first trip, there was people that watched kids, people that watched dogs, people that provided transportation. Oh, yeah, and then there's Bill Moon, which he's on the trip, but that's just, I'm on the trip. I didn't have to hardly do anything to get ready. I packed a couple things, and I went. But Bill Moon is the greatest logistics man I have ever met, and I think he needs to write a book, How You Can Get 8 people in and out of Brazil without losing anybody. He is really good. And there's something else. Oh, you. Every one of you who opened your heart to this work, you make a difference. God let a little bitty church in Gulfport, a church that loves the Word of God, understands the command to go. You provide the money, not all of it, the prayers. You give us words of encouragement and cards to open when we're out there doing our thing. And some of you even take us to the airport and bring us back home. Everybody has a part in this. And that's still not the beginning of this relationship. It started with a God who loves us. And God, whose desire to have a relationship with us is so strong, he sent a Savior who would endure much, who would die an unjust death to become our friend. It started with a God who sent a Holy Spirit that we would never walk alone. And that is where our relationship with the Kimamoa villages began.
You've heard a lot about Delta tonight, and before I get started, I do want to thank you for allowing us to do this. This trip and 4 previous trips and every trip to come. Before I say anything else, I want you to look around a little bit. Look at the walls, look at the ceiling, look at the floors. Go ahead, look. It's okay. I'm not going to do anything while you're looking. We've been talking about building. What you see is a finished product. Behind these walls is a lot of steel girders that you can't see. Written on these steel girders is scriptures and notes and special sayings that some of you put on there. Under the carpet is a lot of cement. Under the cement is a lot more cement. We spent months digging the foundation, filling it up, putting lots of steel in there. Before that, we had to have a plan. We spent years, it seemed like, maybe decades, it seemed like, making a plan. We changed plan two or three times. Remember, we started out, those of you who remember, we started out with a multi-purpose recreation, worship, classroom, something gonna be, we didn't know what it was, building, and then we ended up where we are now. And that took a long time. In building a church in a Quilomboa settlement in Brazil, it's gonna take a long time. Johnny talked about laying the tracks. If you've ever seen them try to build a railroad, you know that you have to smooth out grades. You've got to, some places you've got to fill in holes, some places you've got to bring down hills. You have a lot of work to do in order to make a railroad run. You have the same amount of work to do in building a church, not a building, but a church of people. In building a church of people, a lot of those people are the ones that were out there playing frisbee and wiffle ball. They're the ones who can read and write. Their mamas and daddies are learning the stories. They're passing them along. They're going to begin the church, but that church may still be some time away. Just like this church was some time away when we started the building process here of this building. This is not something that is going to happen overnight. It's not something that's going to happen in the next couple of years. It could, easily could. A man who can read and write could go out and he could begin to establish a church. But in order for the church to be self-sustaining and for Quilomboas to be able to reach Quilomboas, it's going to take time. And I want to thank you for having the vision to get here, where we are. And I want to thank you for having the determination to continue on. We received several instructions in the scripture. Before he left, he said, go tell. And that's all he left us with. Go and make disciples. Go out two by two. He told us how to do it. He told us what to do. He told us where to go. Wherever it hadn't been heard, take somebody with you. Carry your cloak. Make sure you got your sword and a little bit of money. If they'll accept you, like she talked about, great. If they don't accept you, shake the dust off your feet and keep on going. But keep on going. It wasn't a suggestion. It was a command. So as we begin to wrap up tonight, I want you to understand that this is not something that's going to happen in the next couple of years or something that's going to happen in the next few months. We're going to have a church there. We're going to get to see it. I may not get to see it. Maybe be Leah or some of these other younger folks, they'll get to see it. But I get to know that I get to be a part of it.
This we're not done. Thank you, Bill. We have a very special part of our presentation now. We're probably not going to have time tonight to show Duvall's testimony, and it's too rich to rush through. So I'm going to suggest that we save that for next Sunday night. We'll begin the service with that. But we have a very special time right now where we're going to shift focus just a little bit. You're seeing what God is doing through you in Brazil. I want to now shift focus to what's God doing here because of your obedience in Brazil.
okay. I'm much more comfortable teaching a Bible story than I am talking about myself, so bear with me. The first trip I made, TJ and I made actually, to Brazil was in June 2013. And to be honest, I think Randy has alluded to it about 75 times. I was a blubbering fool the entire time. I am an Oklahoman, and I don't know if you know anybody from Oklahoma, but we are Oklahoma, but we are stoic. The only emotions we're supposed to show are anger and mild amusement. But, I mean, I cried the entire time, taking a cold shower. Oh my gosh, this is so great, a cold shower. You know, holes in the mud ground to use the restroom. Oh my gosh, this is wonderful. You know, I don't know. I don't know what it was. I didn't know what it was at the time, but I know what it was now, is that God was breaking me. He was leading me to do something that I'm not capable of doing, am not equipped to do, would never have thought that I would want to do. But it's not about what I want to do. It's not about what I'm equipped to do. It's about our God who does the equipping. So after that June trip, I knew that Brazil was where I was meant to be. Unfortunately, my husband did not know that Brazil was where we needed to be. It took him a little bit longer, about a year and 3 months longer, not that I counted the days, or the hours or the minutes or any of that. But between June and August of 2014, I was miserable. Literally just sick to my stomach, could not sleep, could not study enough, could not pray enough, could not talk to my accountability partners enough, because I knew that the desire of my heart was to be a missionary in Brazil. And finally, man, it takes you a little bit longer. Dr. Richie Allen was preaching here during revival, and TJ turned to me and he said, "We need to go forward." And I'm like, wow, thank you. Well, but anyway, yeah, that was a conversation we had a little bit later. So finally, we were on the same page. And I did not know at the time that he had been going through the same struggles that I had. I think he slept a little bit better than I did, because I might have gotten 2 hours of sleep in the year and some odd months. And we're still working on that. So that now we go fast forward to just last week before last. We're sitting in Brazil, and it was so comfortable. I love it. It's so hot. And it's just, you're eating just strange foods, and it was glorious, and fish heads, and stuff that you don't identify, but you know what? It was great. It was all wonderful. And Richie and Brother Randy sat TJ and I down and said, "So what is your plan?" And we had our plan. Our plan was flawless. We had it down. I'm going to work another year at the school. I will resign in the year 2016. That way I have a year to save some money. And just as an aside, I got my dividend statement from my personal savings account. And in the last quarter, I made a penny. So I'm now up to $55.63. So we're good. So we're set financially. I mean, that's it. That's all we need. And then I realized, as Richie was talking, he said, "Why 2016? Well, I need a year to save money. I have $55.63 in my savings account. I have a car I need to pay for. I have a periodontist that I need to send his children to college. You know, a variety of things such as that. I want to go to school." And then Richie and Randy started talking about Abraham. And in Genesis chapter 4, or Genesis chapter 12, verse 4, Abraham had been just told to get up and go. Take your stuff, gather your stuff, and go. And the first word in chapter 12, verse 4 is, "So." And I know, I pray they didn't feel the utter disgust I had at that moment for myself. Because I had replaced the word "so" with "but first." But, well, yeah, this is what I know that you called us to do, but first, let me save some money. But first, you know, let me put a little bit more money in my retirement account at school. But first, let me take care of the special needs kids who I love dearly. But first, let me be comfortable in what I need to do. And it was just like a slap in the face. So, I'm not adding or subtracting from the Bible anymore. And, well, administrators of Past Christian High School, I'm resigning in May. I've been accepted into seminary. I will start one class in the spring because I will still be coaching. I will fulfill my obligations to Past Christian Public Schools because it's the right moral thing to do. Now, as far as, and Abraham, I don't know if he went skipping down the road. I'm not skipping down the road. I am terrified. I feel physically ill. But I would rather be obedient and do what God has called us to do, TJ and I, than be disobedient and be miserable. In James chapter 2, verse 26, says that we show faith by our works. So I started thinking to myself, too, am I actually going to step out, or am I going to talk about stepping out? Because talking about stepping out isn't faith, it's lip service. And if God has called you to do something, then you do it. And if you don't do it, then prepare to be miserable. And I'm tired of being miserable. So, with that said, as far as our mission work on the field, I texted Brian today and I said, look, how long did it take Paul, after he had his conversion experience on the road to Damascus, for him to go out and disciple others? And you know what? Paul did not have that conversion experience and then start discipling immediately, start his mission work immediately. It took years. You have to be trained. You have to have the full armor of God on before you can wage battle, before you can enter into a battlefield. And so TJ and I are going to work together. We are going to be trained through LinkUp and through Brother Randy and Brian and anybody else who wants to help us, because we need to learn the good side of ministry and we need to learn the ugly side of ministry as well. So are we going back in June? Yes. Are we going back in June as employees of LinkUp Missions? I don't know, because we're not there yet. Paul ran a race with endurance. And endurance, that tells me right there that it is a marathon. It's cross country. It's not a 50-yard dash. It's something that you push through the pain, you push through the pleasure, you do what God has called you to do. So as a result of that, I'm excited. I can't wait. And I guess I'll go ahead and tell my administration Monday that I'm quitting, just in case it gets back to them. Oh, yeah, by the way, you know, thanks for playing. But I'm excited, but we covet your prayers, because this is a huge, huge leap of faith. I'm leaving a job that I love, or children that I love, but I'm leaving children who I love, and going back to school at an age where I really should be not going back to school. So pray for an open mind, pray for learning, pray for discernment. And I'm also more excited about this time of our lives than I have been in years. And I'm not miserable anymore. So, and I can sleep. I'm up to at least 4 hours a night. So so that's exciting. And I'm hoping maybe eventually when we're on the mission field, I'll be up to, you know, 5 or 6. So we covet your prayers. And we thank you that you've allowed us to learn what God has called us to do. And we thank God for putting that burden on both of our hearts. And I want to end with this, the picture of the feet. This was our theme of the days that we were there. It's from Romans 10:15. And it's, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. And the good news is, and I don't know if Brother Randy was going to say this, but I've got the mic now, so I might as well take advantage of it, is we have received word that there are 2 new believers in Fortaleza. So And that, and people, and I'll finish with this, people have asked, well, can't you do what you're doing here instead of flying all those miles and spending all that money in Brazil? Well, yes, but God said go, and I'm not willing to put a price on the souls of these two people who have been saved. So thank you very much.
All right, now I've got the mic, Carrie. Okay, next week we'll start the service with Duval's testimony. I want y'all to hear that. We got a business meeting at 6:30. You can't go get your Awana youngins until 6:30. So is it okay if we go another 5-10 minutes? Is that all right? But don't knock yourself out saying, yeah, let's have 5 more minutes of church. If you got to leave, go ahead and leave. I just want to summarize to make sure that Bel Air Baptist Church is fully in the loop, because you are a big part of this. You're as big a part as the ones, as the team members have said, that are going. Without you, there would be no teams going. So understand, and the team did a wonderful job, and you see tonight through the earnestness of this presentation how serious we are taking this partnership in Brazil. We trained for months, and I'll tell you what, we're going to train more, because every time we go, we learn more and we adjust more. And now I understand, I've got my work cut out writing some more training, and Brian will probably get roped into helping me. But we're going to have to write some classes on cross-cultural ministry, J2. We're going to have to write some classes on storying, and we're going to open that up for the whole church. You know, you can be able to come to these classes. If you're going on the next trip, probably mandatory. But this is such a wonderful, wonderful thing. I have had the joy of being mentored by some of the most godliest people in Southern Baptist life, people like Bill Cook and others. And I've had the great privilege of being associated with a lot of great churches, but none of them have I ever been as proud of and joy-filled in Bel Air Baptist Church. I'm telling you, what we're doing here right now is the most exciting thing I've ever been involved in ministry, because I know it's something that's making an eternal difference, and you need to know that. Bill did a wonderful job of illustrating that you have to pace yourself if you're going to build a physical church. Well, we're not building buildings, but it was a great illustration of how we got to pace ourselves to build a church, which is the people, believers. And when we can get a church, when Bel Air Baptist Church can rejoice and have a special service on down the road, I want you to plan on this and have a time of celebration that we have a Quilombola church in Fortaleza or some one of these other Quilombola villages. That's when the gospel is going to explode among these unreached people. So with that being said, I want to make sure you understand that there's three phases in our partnership of what we're doing. We are early in phase one. For you retirees, think about phase one, phase two of the, you know, condos or something that you're living in. But, you know, that fell like a 20-pound rock. Okay, three phases. We're early into phase one. Phase one is your initial contact with the village. That's where Mission Living Water comes in, the water pots and things. We go in and they accept us and they invite us in, and we begin to make these relationships you've heard about tonight. In phase one, you begin to share the gospel, and you have to be patient like you've heard tonight. And now, where there was no believers, now there's 8, counting these last two. Isn't that wonderful? And then in phase one, when you get some believers, then you start also not just evangelizing when you go back and training the churches. You start training the churches on how to disciple the believers, because they're starting literally just like our kids do. And you know, kindergarten, learning from scratch. So we're doing two things now. We're trying to discipleship believers. We're trying to evangelize more to be believers, phase one. At phase two, at some point, you have enough believers to where you start teaching them ecclesiology, that's, you know, the church, and you start discipling these believers what a church is and how a church works and all that. So phase two, we hopefully end with the church in this village. And then phase three, we begin to teach this church in the Quilombola village missiology. That, hey, look what God has done for you. Now, you have a great commission just like we did when we came to Brazil, to go to your own people and reach them. And that's when the gospel will explode in Brazil. So I wanted to try to lay that out. It's not real complicated. It's overwhelming, though, from a human perspective. But God is a God who's able to do the impossible. Amen? All right. Well, thank you for being patient. Does anybody here have a question? Do y'all have any questions about our partnership, your partnership, or anything? You clear as mud? Donnie, you got a question?
No, I wish you'd share with what the president of Fort Lake shared one night about the water park and what they've done in their business.
Yeah, the water parks, we asked the president, as Johnny said, at Fortaleza, what difference, because it's been 2 years since you all took the first water parks into Fortaleza. That was our initial foray down there. And in 2 years, she reported that their illnesses had decreased, over 50%, that her village was much healthier, and she just could not say enough in the way of thanks and gratitude for what we've done. And then we got to tell them about the living water, and that's really good. What else? Anything else? Y'all ready to go, aren't you? Y'all being American on me. See, if you was Brazilian right now, you wouldn't care about the time. But we're in America, so we'll try to honor the time. Anybody got a question? All right. Next week, we're going to play Duval's testimony. It's worth seeing. It's worth not rushing through. And that's why we'll save it for next week. Okay? Couldn't be prouder of these people you heard from. Bill Moon, I mean, we wouldn't be where we are without him doing all the logistical work. It allows me to do the pastoral work. And it just couldn't be done without that division of labor. And everybody that goes. I mean, if y'all aren't proud of them, I guess I'm proud enough for everybody. Amen? Go ahead. All right, here's what I want to do. I'm going to ask Sister Carrie to come up here. And she has asked for prayer. Sister Carrie, would you mind? Everybody come on up, and let's gather around her. I want the ladies to come and lay hands on Carrie. What a wonderful... Let's give Carrie another hand for being obedient. You ladies, gather around her to lay hands, and the men will gather around the outside of you ladies. And we are going to pray for her. And I'm going to ask, when everybody gets up here and gets in place, Jennifer, would you pray when everybody gets... Do you mind?
Father God, we come to you this evening, Lord, to pray for our sister. Lord, we love her. We lift her up to you and all that she's dealing with, the overwhelming, just everything that she has to go through right now to prepare for the road that you put her and TJ on. Father, I pray that you would ease her concerns. Pray that you would give her the peace that only you can give her, Father. I pray that she realizes that she has the entire body of Christ behind her, and that he would not lead her to do anything that he would not support her in. Father, I pray that she and TJ would rely fully on you, that through every obstacle that they may face, that every trial that they come upon, Father, that they would grow stronger, and that they would relax and know that you are holding them in the palm of your hand. Lord, I pray this, all of this, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.